I'm Jishnu, and you are listening to Q for Quarantine. In times when not everything is at its best, when times are scary and most of us don't know what to expect from life anymore, I'm here to help you out with it. Until 2 weeks ago, what I wouldn't give to get a month to sit in my room and work on projects that I've been putting off for a while now. How I would love the idea of someone telling me, "Hey, all your classes will be online and all you have to do is stay home and do your thing." But 4 days into quarantine, I have discovered that one of the major factors that make us enjoy isolation is our choice. When isolation and quarantine is imposed upon us, may it be for our own safety, one can feel powerless. The Prime Minister of India issued a 21-day lockdown this week, all for the well-being of the people. But the lockdown had repercussions.
Hi Jishnu, this is Divya here. I'm a counseling psychologist. And when this whole pandemic began with the COVID-19, I was in Goa for a workshop with a bunch of people. I think initially I thought I was the most fortunate person on this planet to have been in Goa, away from all this fear consciousness that was all around. There were people panicking, news channels circulating all kinds of news. And I was just experiencing an immense sense of relief that thank goodness I'm away from all of it.
And as her workshop got over, she booked a flight to go home. But our Prime Minister declared a curfew and her flights got cancelled.
There was a bit of panic about, okay, I need to go back. What's going to happen? And that's when the anxiety started kicking in. It was scary because all the hotels had got the circular that they needed to close down and they were literally just waiting for us to check out so that they could leave. I mean, it's Goa, I don't know anybody, and if the hotel shuts, I don't have a place to go. I think the sense of relief I have felt on reaching the airport and boarding my flight, I've never felt that way before. And yeah, I was in and out of the airport in like 15 minutes, probably less. Everywhere you go, there were people in masks and they were really, really, really scared. It's like, we don't want to be there, but we just need to get home.
Going back home can be stressful for many of us. But at the same time, going back home, regardless of the existence of a family, can be greatly relaxing for some. For us, the ones who can book a flight despite the price hikes, getting home is much easier. But for the laborers and daily wage workers living in big cities, affording life in a metro without work became impossible. And they struggled to go back home.
काम करने के लिए काम भी बंद हो गया ना हम लोग का हाथ में रेशन पानी है ना हम लोग का हाथ में पैसा है ना हम लोग का हाथ में कुछ भी नहीं है हम लोग भूखे प्यासे में मर रहा हूं यहां
छोटे बाल बच्चे सब भी सबके लिए परेशानी बढ़ गया है मान लो सियान आदमी है थोड़ा भूखा भी बर्दाश्त भी कर सकते हैं बच्चे के लिए यहां तक पानी तहत भी के साधन नहीं है कि जो पानी भी पीने वाला आएगा पानी के लिए भी कोई सुविधा नहीं है
पानी भी घर खरीद को पीना पड़ता है भैया बीमारी उमारी सब है यही में कुछ घर में खर्च
अंडर लॉकडाउन with landlords threatening to throw out the belongings of these workers who are so essential to our society, with no proper food rationing and non-existent healthcare, a vast majority of low-income groups might be safe from the virus, but their hunger, pain and suffering might not be mild enough for them to survive. The government might have proposed grand schemes for these people, but these schemes are yet to be executed while the backbone of our economy ceases to exist. For a lot of people, this quarantine is proving to be extremely productive, a time full of self-discovery and all that. But not for everyone. Artists and students from around the world are feeling the pressure to do more, make the most out of these days. And for the ones who look forward to attending school or even taking that one walk in the neighborhood, this quarantine is proving to be mentally taxing. I am aware of my privileges, and in no way am I saying that my struggles or the issues that artists and art students are facing around the world are remotely close to the ones of the underprivileged daily wage earners whose life has come to an absolute standstill. But speaking about mental health during times like these is extremely important. Humans are really social animals. Hours of FaceTime cannot give us the satisfaction of being near our loved ones. Days of isolation can make our creativity come to a staggering halt, especially if we are living alone. More on that after this break. This is only our third episode, and I'm so very proud to say that all proceeds made from this podcast will be donated to the World Health Organization COVID-19 Solidarity Response Fund. Since they launched it less than 2 weeks ago, the fund has raised over $95 million. If you have the means to support the ones in need in any which way, I would like to urge you to do so. Q for Quarantine is now available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Snitcher, YouTube, or wherever you listen. If you like what you're listening to, do consider sharing it with the ones who might enjoy content like this. With more listeners, it gets easier for us to support the causes we believe in. A huge thank you to the ones who are already listening and the ones who listened last week. We are back. While thinking about the struggles of the art community during this quarantine, I was wondering how art plays a role in a pandemic, especially since social media has made artists so easily accessible to a large audience. I asked Bhavna, known as Kidovna on Instagram.
Every picture speaks a thousand words, right? At least that's what I always think about when I associate art with the pandemic. Although what the artwork speaks is secondary. I remember a friend of mine telling me that she would forward me a pamphlet on safety measures and how it wasn't a boring document and that it came with quote-unquote fun illustrations. I think that sums up quite a lot.
When we run out of explanations and assurance, art is where we look for refuge.
So last Friday, my art college, very abruptly, like the rest of the world, announced that the college would be closed till the 5th of April.
That's Hafsa, from Lahore, Pakistan.
It was honestly the best news I heard since the new year. So much of my commission work and exhibition work had been piling up, and I couldn't wait to finish them up. And finally, I have this opportunity to sit back at home in my room without any distraction whatsoever and just paint my heart out.
Years ago, she was gripped by what the doctors called a chronic disease. It was somehow expected of her to break down and get sad with life. But Hafsa, a painter and an art student, did not let that happen.
Despite my doctor hinting that he can't really do anything to save me, I didn't believe that I was going to die. There is so much of art that I still had to make. So painting and watching movies and listening to K-pop, it really helped to give me strength and helped me to heal in ways that my medication just couldn't. My immune system became stronger. I started regaining my appetite. My medication remained the same, except for a small change in it. And it was just that because I refused to believe, and art helped me to do that, I refused to believe that I could die without producing any art.
Pablo Picasso once said, "The purpose of art is washing the dust of daily life off our souls." As we get unsure about what the future holds, we must buy time. Time for the curve to flatten, time for the doctors to come up with a vaccine, time for the world to heal. Creativity will take care of that. Days into quarantine, however, many of us who create started facing challenges we didn't pay much attention to in the beginning. Anika and I went to school together. Now we both study art and design at Premier Institutes. We were texting about things that we are both going through right now, in lockdown. And we couldn't help but get on call to talk about the mental well-being of artists during quarantine. That on the next episode of Q for Quarantine. I've listed most of the resources that I found online, and you can always reach out to me to start a conversation on Twitter. I'm always available at Jishnu Bando, that's at JISHNU_BANDO. I'm also on Instagram at JishYouWish, JISHYOUWISH. I am Jishnu and you were listening to Q for Quarantine. This podcast is available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Snitcher, YouTube, or wherever you listen. You can follow Q for Quarantine at the QFQ Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. This was our third episode. Thank you for listening. Stay home. Stay safe.